I'm Sarah Deas, and I'm a co-founder of the Wellbeing Economy Alliance here in Scotland. I'm also the chair of the expert advisory panel to North Ayrshire on community wellbeing, which you've heard a few things about already today. It's lovely to be in this newly refurbished setting. My experience of coming to Saltcoats has been very different over the years. I'm a sea kayaker, so what's always brought me to Saltcoats has been to the Auchenhavy Leisure Centre, where on cold, wintry nights we had our practice sessions and I learned to roll a kayak. So much better to be here on the public platform today in the dry and enjoying this conference with you. So this session is about how can community wealth building be used by policymakers to overcome local economic issues. And I'm joined by Sarah McKinley, Katrina Mackay, McAuley, sorry, and Stuart McDonald. And I'll introduce them at each stage of the proceedings. So just a little bit of scene setting on my part, really reflecting back on some of the messages we've already heard this morning. The Wellbeing Economy Alliance is an alliance of organisations all calling for systems change. And another first for North Ayrshire Council, and that it was the first council in Scotland to become a member of the Wellbeing Economy Alliance, which obviously is a great plus. And it also reflects the fact that community wealth building, which is at the heart of North Ayrshire's strategy, is all about building a wellbeing economy, a wellbeing economy from the ground up. This is about systems change. And as a policy framework, community wealth building seeks to reconfigure economic flows, helping keeping the wealth and the flows of money within the locality, helping to weave together the social, economic, and environmental drivers. It has an ethos of pre-distribution. That's a new word to many of us, but we're all very familiar with the word redistribution. In contrast, community wealth building is all about getting it right first time by pre-distributing wealth within the economy. It enables individuals to have a genuine stake in their economic environment. But it's not easy, as we will find out and explore through this session. It requires quite radical change of thinking. It requires joined up policy making, and that's the focus of our discussion here today. Joined up policy making across pillars, five pillars, across partners. And it requires a collective approach between collaboration, between anchors, between businesses, and between the community and individuals. So I'm going to now introduce our first speaker, who will give us a much deeper insight. Sarah McKinley is a real expert in community wealth building. We've known each other for quite a time, and Sarah is the Director of Community Wealth Building Programmes at the Democracy Collaborative. She's based in Brussels and has the remit to promote this approach to economic development in the UK, in Europe, and in the US, sharing best practices and promoting partnerships between organisations. So she has a wealth of experience that we can benefit from here today. She has background in community development and has co-authored a number of publications. So Sarah, the platform's yours.
Thank you, Sarah. That's quite an introduction. I'm not sure I can live up to it. Only one correction to that. I think all of you are experts, and I'm really a learner, and I'm here to learn and connect and join the dots. So that's really my role. So first of all, I'm sure it's gonna be said a million times today, but I do actually have to say it, that it is wonderful to be here in person, in the flesh, with human beings, not screens, for the first time in a really long time. I have had the true honor of being involved in North Ayrshire and the hard work that's been going on here as a member of the expert advisory panel, but even before that, when the groundwork was being laid here to start thinking about community wealth building, I was involved in the launch in 2020, and it was on a computer screen, which in one way has enabled us to get a really broad audience, and that was wonderful, but it's amazing now to finally be in person to be able to celebrate these things. So thank you so much to the team for the hard work. It's hard to put on an in-person event at any time. It's particularly hard to do it after 2 years of forgetting how to do it. So really appreciate all of you and the hard work, and I'm just grateful to be here as part of this excellent movement and with my colleagues on the panel. So before I do that, I want to step back and just say a little bit about the Democracy Collaborative. I feel like we've heard the name Democracy Collaborative a number of times already today, and it's sort of like, what the heck is that? So let me just tell you a little bit about what the Democracy Collaborative is and what we do. So we are a US-based think tank, but we are a think and do tank. So we do research, but we also do advisory work and engagement in community with actors in place across the globe. We predominantly work in the US and the UK, so transatlantically, and we work around models of how to democratize the economy, right? How can we build a more democratic economy so that people are more engaged and have more control and benefit from the control of their economic futures? How can they make decisions and benefit from them, from the economy? So everyone here knows what community wealth building is. It's very important for community wealth building to make sense to the place where it is working, so it's important to have your own understanding of it for North Ayrshire, for Ayrshire, for Scotland. What is community wealth building? That said, there are really important key elements of what community wealth building is, and I want to stress that because I think sometimes it gets lost in the complexity of all the different approaches and elements within community wealth building. At its heart, community wealth building is economic development. Let me just stress that, it is economic development. It's not a nice side project to ameliorate the ill effects of our economy, right? It's not, as Sarah was just saying, it's not sort of a redistributive approach to fixing the problems of our broken system, right? It is about changing that system. It is about building a new economy. It is about how you create a more just, a more resilient, a more equitable economy of place. And the way that community wealth building does that is through direct ownership of assets. So the people and the place benefit from the wealth that is being generated by those assets, right? Assets create wealth. And right now, the way our economy is set up is most of that wealth is actually sucked out, extracted. It is extracted from people through their labor. It is extracted from land through its exploitation. All these things that we know. Community wealth building changes that, keeps that wealth in the hands of the people that created it in the first place for their benefit through institutional design and new forms of ownership, right? Through pre-distribution, as Sarah was just saying, building institutions, building new forms of ownership in place that can weather that change, that can weather all changes, I should say. So we've heard about the pillars of community wealth building. Again, the pillars are a part of every local economy. There are nuances to your own particular context, but as Ted, my boss actually this morning was saying on a screen, these pillars cannot operate in isolation, right? They cannot exist separated from one another. And we heard great examples already in the last panel about how all of these things come together in their own system. They're systemically connected, and that's how they displace and disrupt the larger economic system that we live in. They can't do that on their own. There are wonderful examples of really powerful progressive ownership forms in each of these pillars, but on their own, they actually can't address our needs of place. I was struck when I was listening to the previous panel, and Lisa said, this is basic stuff. And in some ways, you know, I don't want to belittle how difficult it is to do this work, because it's really difficult, but at its heart, this is basic, it's essential. The economy is meeting our needs, the needs of people in place, or it should be. It's currently not, but it should be. That's what the economy should be doing. And so we need to get back to that. And listening to those presentations earlier, particularly the presentation on the solar farm, it struck me of how like common sense this is, how obvious this should be. We consume and use energy. Where do we get it from? We should produce that locally. And if we're producing it locally, the people who live here should be producing it, and they should be benefiting from it. And the money and the wealth that's created from that should come back into it and recirculate. And so when all of these are connected, when all of the five elements of the community wealth building are connected, that's really how you begin to displace that extractive activity and make things like the solar farm the new normal. It's a wonderful example, and we need more. We need many, many, many more. We need bigger. We can do that here in North Ayrshire, but if it's only happening in North Ayrshire, and it's not happening elsewhere in Scotland, and it's not happening elsewhere in the UK, as we know it's not, and it's not happening elsewhere globally, then it's only a blip. We need to start to actually have these get to the scale of the need. And so Russell was saying this is a global movement, right? This is happening all over the world. Of course, by my lovely accent, you can tell I originate from the US. And in fact, that's where the term community wealth building was first originated as an economic development framework in the US in 2005 in the lovely city of Cleveland, right up there by the lakes, a post-industrial region as well that took this on. I just want to say that, so I am not very tech savvy, so I put some dots on a map. This is not accurate, nor is it to scale, but it's vaguely illustrative of where things are going on. Elements of community wealth building, community land trusts, cooperatives, employee-owned enterprises, community development, financial institutions, exist in communities all over the world. And in fact, a lot of them have their antecedents in the global south, in parts of Africa and Latin America. So that is all over the world. It's in every community. What I've tried to capture here, and I think that's what I'm trying to stress in my comments today, is what makes community wealth building different is how it connects all of those things, how it connects that systemically and makes those things greater than the sum of their parts, makes them scalable, makes them replicable in other places. And so, yes, everything is important in the context of place, but we can learn from one another. We can build that momentum, as Russell was saying, and grow this movement to understand that this is the new normal, the way we should be doing things, as my colleague Neil said, the new common sense. This is the way our economies should work. And let me just end with, you know, the importance then of local government in that specifically, in making this a coherent frame. And I applaud North Ayrshire for really taking the lead on that, because this work should be happening in communities everywhere, and we should empower communities to do that work on the ground. But if it is not connected up, then it cannot scale, it cannot displace, it cannot act as a redistributive force to institutionalize this change for the long haul. We need the policy, we need the resource, we need the connection, we need the assets and the enabling infrastructure that local government provides. And that's the appropriate role for local government. And of course, we all own local government, just like we now all own that solar farm, right? It's publicly owned, and we can make decisions and enforce transparency and accountability for that use. And so we need to reclaim that and laud that and recognize the important role in government in getting to that scale that we need. So thank you, I'll stop ranting.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Thank you, it's great to set that context. We'll have opportunity, as before, to do questions and answers at the end of the panel presentations. So please start thinking about things that you'd like to explore with us. So next up is Caitriona McAuley, who is Head of Economic Development and Regeneration at North Ayrshire Council. Caitriona's probably way well known to you all, having worked in a number of councils in the west of Scotland. In fact, actually, for me, I've known Caitriona for a couple of years as chair of the expert advisory panel, and Caitriona is one of the champions from the council who attends those meetings, but we've never met in person till today. So it's lovely to meet you and others that I'm meeting for the first time today, and look forward to hearing how you can share the journey of community wealth building in North Ayrshire with everybody here.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. It's hard to follow two of our experts and our other experts in the room as well. We wouldn't be where we are now without their guidance and advice and the information that, they've brought to inform our work. And you know, as you'll hear throughout the day, I think this morning session was just that initial look at some of the pillars and the work we are doing. But I think if you stay with us throughout the day, you will get a deeper and a more fuller understanding of the scope and the scale of the work that is underway in North Ayrshire, and particularly some of the questions that came in that question session. You know, feel free to ask some of those questions again, because different members of the panel will have a different perspective on that, and they are all very relevant questions that were being asked. So my role here today is to talk to you about the journey that we've been on in North Ayrshire, and it's one that we've been on for some time. We began this work in 2016 when we started working on an inclusive growth diagnostic, and that was done in partnership with the Scottish Government, and another first of its kind to be used in this way in Scotland. And the purpose of the diagnostic was to identify the constraints and the opportunities for driving inclusive growth in North Ayrshire. It also identified particular groups of people most excluded from traditional economic development approaches. And we identified four key groups: young people, females, and people experiencing long-term health issues, and people experiencing in-work poverty. North Ayrshire also faces a range of social, economic, and environmental challenges. The region has struggled to recover from deindustrialisation, with large swathes of vacant and derelict land. Over a quarter of children are living in poverty. We have high unemployment rates and one of the lowest job densities in Scotland. In 2019, we declared a climate emergency, as we recognise that climate change has the potential for huge economic and social and environmental impacts, and with the most vulnerable in society often suffering the most. And we knew that traditional approaches to economic development were not working for North Ayrshire, and that that different approach was needed to ensure that the economy is truly inclusive and everyone is able to participate and benefit from the successes and opportunities. So our work on the inclusive growth diagnostic paved the way for community wealth building, which we saw as a practical mechanism for achieving inclusive wellbeing economy, one which is based on fairness, resilience, and grows in a sustainable way and does not compromise social or environmental well-being. So in 2019, we began working with the Manchester-based consultancy CLES to undertake a community wealth-building diagnostic involving services and staff from across the council. The results of that diagnostic went on to inform the development of the North Ayrshire Community Wealth-Building Strategy. As already mentioned, we launched that in May 2020, and that was done on Facebook Live and during lockdown, another first of its kind in Scotland. The strategy outlines our comprehensive and holistic approach to community wealth building. It sets out 55 actions aligned to all five pillars, with an overarching mission of enhancing local wealth, the creation of fair jobs, and maximising the potential of all our places through working in partnership with our communities and businesses. Community wealth building is a transformative approach, and it requires time and resources to change practices and ensure it is firmly embedded within organisations. And the council took the decision to invest in new staff roles to undertake this work. To act as a sounding board and a critical friend for this new approach, we did not have all the answers. We established the expert advisory panel, a team of leading economic experts, to assist us with our community wealth building plans and help review and develop our strategy and plans as we progressed. Within the strategy, we recognised the key to successful delivery of community wealth building is about collaboration and working in partnership to add value to the work we all do and to ensure that positive long-term transformational change. To facilitate this collaboration, we established the Community Wealth Building Commission, a partnership of 9 anchor organisations, including all 3 Ayrshire councils, the NHS Ayrshire and Arran, Ayrshire College,
the Ayrshire Community Trust, Police Scotland, and Scottish Fire and Rescue Services, and Scottish Enterprise. They have all demonstrated their commitment to this approach. To aid that collaboration and to support the anchors to use their economic levers and amend their practices to align with community wealth building, we developed the Anchor Charter, which has already been referred to. The Anchor Charter has 16 pledges aligned across those five community wealth building pillars, and then we added a sixth pillar on climate change. So we have 11 organisations that are signed up to that charter, including all three of the health and social care integration joint boards. And we're delighted by that support. We also established a lead officer working group from across the commission members and have created three regional work streams focusing on exploring the potential collaborative opportunities associated with procurement, land and assets, and fair employment. And it's important to say that the representation on that lead officer working group was from across disciplines within those organisations. So it was procurement leads, it was surveyors and estates leads, land and assets, as well as economic development and employee colleagues and our HR colleagues. Our collaborative approach to community wealth building is further driven by the £3 million Community Wealth Building Fund that is part of the Ayrshire Growth Deal. This project, which seeks to enhance wealth, ensure fair and meaningful employment, and create successful places across Ayrshire. The three-year programme commenced in spring last year, and it has three key dimensions. There are three community wealth building locality officers recruited within each of the local authorities, so that's nine in total across Ayrshire, and a programme manager. We also have a new Fair Work Ayrshire service has been created to support local businesses embed Fair Work activities, and we have three staff delivering that service, and that does relate to the question asked about those people in poverty. We are very much driving a Fair Work agenda with local businesses and employers. And we also have a Community Wealth Building Business Support Fund, and that's now available to support all of these activities, including social enterprise development, employee ownership models, cooperative development, and supplier development opportunities. In 2021, the Ayrshire Regional Economic Partnership agreed to commission the development of a new regional economic strategy for Ayrshire. The strategy is currently in development, led by CLES, who've been commissioned to undertake this work, and it will have community wealth building at its heart. You will hear more about that next, on the development of the new strategy from Stuart. We recognise that our approach in North Ayrshire is still very much a journey. We are learning about what works, what doesn't, how to overcome challenges, and where there is opportunity to push ourselves further. We don't consider ourselves to have all the answers, and we know that the path we are taking to implementing community wealth building in North Ayrshire won't necessarily be the most appropriate for other local authorities. It is important to recognise that community wealth building is not a one-size-fits-all approach, and practices must adapt to the challenges and opportunities of that particular area. So, for example, in North Ayrshire, we have significant levels of vacant and derelict land and property, so we recognise that that was a real opportunity to focus on the repurposing of that asset to achieve economic, social or environmental outputs that would benefit local people and businesses, and the solar farm developments are a really good example of that. So as part of our community wealth building approach, we developed a new regeneration delivery plan, and that included key projects such as the Lockshore Park, a new repurposing property grant fund, and that provides support to local landowners and community groups to bring back land and properties into productive use. A number of community-led projects which are now in delivery, including the Millport Town Hall regeneration and the Stevenson Beach Hub project. Also the repurposing of some of the council's vacant property, including in Bank Street development in Irvine, of converting former commercial property into new townhouses. And we're currently working on new place frameworks in development in Largs, Kilwinning and Saltcoats to identify new priorities. So earlier this week, I was delighted to attend the official opening of the Lockshore Park Hub. And that's a key community wealth building project, regenerating a major long-term strategic site bringing 65 hectares of vacant and derelict land back into productive use. It was the site of a former steelworks, the Glengarnock Steelworks, and was purchased by the council from Scottish Enterprise in 2021. There have been a number of previous master planning exercises with that site, none of which came to fruition. But the site is now an excellent example of a productive asset for the community, with a cafe, public toilets, including a changing places facility to ensure the site is truly accessible for people with disabilities, a workshop space and sports facilities. The visitor hub is very much the kickstart to that project, and it will support the delivery of a four-phased master plan. The next phases of that are now subject of a £10 million bid to the UK government for levelling up funding support. The wider master plan will seek to enhance the outdoor space further through recreation of new active travel routes, recreational and sports facilities, woodlands and park and play facilities for children. We welcome the announcement by the Scottish Government to establish a Community Wealth Building Act and look forward to seeing how this develops and how it can support local authorities and other anchor institutions to meaningfully and sustainably embed community wealth building practices within their organisations. Local authorities are really well placed to recognise and respond to the particular economic challenges and opportunities within their communities, and they should be empowered to do so through well-resourced statutory economic development teams. We believe that a truly impactful and transformative community wealth building bill would need to work across numerous portfolios, streamline processes and unlock the barriers which prevent local economies embedding and utilising community wealth building practices to their full potential. It should remain firmly committed to the principles of community wealth building, but should also acknowledge that local autonomy and flexibility is required for different areas to maximise their unique assets and opportunities. So as we continue our journey in North Ayrshire, we remain committed to its core values of community wealth building, creating a local economy which is fairer, more resilient and inclusive to all. I hope this has provided some insight and context to the steps we have taken, and the Council looks forward to continue to work in partnership with our local communities, businesses and wider regional anchor institutions. Thank you.
The expert advisory group has input in a couple of sessions. We've got our third session next week. So the strategy is still very much in development. And so I'm personally very interested to see how it's progressing and what insights you can share at this stage. Stuart.
My chief exec Sarah really wanted to be here, but she's currently travelling towards Aberdeen for the conference this weekend. So she sends her apologies and sends me instead. But having three Sarahs on one panel, another first. But anyway. Now, just want to start by saying I spend a lot of my time working across the UK with the various local authorities, trying to convince them that community wealth building is the way forward. It is the way that we need to build an inclusive economy. So I'm really heartened and humbled to be stood here and listening to a panel, listening to speakers, and listening to the depth of work that you've done in 2 years, from your strategy to a real intent and a real rewiring of your economy built on community wealth building principles. So we've been commissioned to develop a regional economic strategy for the whole of Ayrshire. We believe it's the first regional economic strategy in at least a good while. We also believe it's the first regional economic strategy built on community wealth building principles. So we're hoping it's a another part of that rewiring of the system, building that framework in which regional partners can come together and live these principles of community wellbeing. And I have to say, the process of delivering this work so far has been breathtakingly enjoyable, because there's such thirst, such desire among the wider partners across Ayrshire to do something different, to challenge the prevailing orthodoxy of traditional economics. Traditional economics has failed so many places, but that desire to do something different is really strong when it comes across. I think speaking to one of our colleagues from Perth, he was asking about the CPP. All three CPPs I've spoken to, absolutely, this is what we should be doing. We don't want a traditional regional economic strategy. We need something different, and it needs to come now. So really hard to be working in such an environment. So for those of you who don't know, I work for CLES, Centre for Local Economic Strategies. We call ourselves the National Organisation for Local Economies. And we borrowed many ideas from TED, 10 years ago, to really bring the community wealth building agenda to the UK, to build a movement, and championed by Neil for most of those 10 years, to really build community wealth building as a movement across the UK. But as Sarah said, it's not happening everywhere. Now, there are places where this type of thinking is still a challenge to embed across various institutions. These are the types of places that CLES have been working, and Sarah, you want to send me your map back?
Yours is nicer.
So you can see the breadth, but you can see the Scottish component of really building that community wellbeing agenda in the UK. So this new regional economic strategy, commissioned by the three councils, really gives us an opportunity to do something different. As I said, I think it's the first time a regional strategy has been developed for Ayrshire, but also the first time that one has been built on community wellbeing principles. It's intentional, and it's intentional in that it wants to address the unique challenges that we face, and to work with our partners to develop a step change, and all partners that we've engaged with really do want to see a step change in economic policy making. We need to move beyond our measures of GVA as a measure of success. The desire for a well-being economy is really strong, so we need to build a policy framework in which that can be achieved. We set these six foundational principles for delivering this work. We felt this was really important to get right at the outset, working with partners. So we need to be inclusive and targeted, really focusing our work on supporting those people who are furthest from the labour market, who are experiencing multiple economic disadvantages, and who we can use our levers of power to shape different outcomes for. We need to act against the often harsh and extractive forces of capitalism, which have shaped people's places in the economy. And we need to change how they relate to their economy and how they can fulfill their role within their economy, within their local economy. We need to build trust, and we need to deepen collaboration across the region. We've been working in our local authority areas for a long time, and those regional structures are new and emerging, and they need investment. And any relationship, for it to be successful, for it to be sustained, and for it to be deepened, needs investment. We need to be evidence-based, but we also need to be imaginative. We need to be able to pilot new things. We need to be fleet of foot. We need to be able to test things. We need to be okay with things not working, because we just try again. Keep going. going and keep going. We need to be ambitious, but we need to be responsive. And if anything, the last few years have shown us that crisis after crisis are coming quicker and quicker. We don't have time to sit around and deliberate for 2 years about how to do something. We need to be responsive. These crises, they just keep coming. We need to be place-based, but we need to speak powerfully with one voice. So across Ayrshire, we've got multiple local authorities, a whole host of anchor institutions. And community wealth building, of course, is uber local. So how does that work at a regional scale? We need a regional framework because many of the challenges are shared and universal. But many of the responses need to be embedded with our own local communities and our own ways of doing things. So those were the kind of broad foundational principles. This diagram is probably too small, but it sets out the approach that we've taken so far. This is a strategy which is still in development. We're kind of at this stage. We're at the kind of final draft consultation phase. There's still opportunity to shape some of this and to feedback and to comment, and I'd be welcome to have a conversation with anyone in this room about their thoughts about how community wellbeing works at a regional scale. We set this vision, I'm not going to read it before, but I'll pick out some highlights. So we're looking for a region where wealth is shared fairly. There are not many regional economic strategies which start with that premise. We're looking to protect our natural wealth and our culture and be ready to adapt to the challenges of the future. There are three key shifts that we feel that need to occur for this strategy to be successful. A shift to that deeper collaboration at regional level, regional work. A shift to regional economic strategy, which has a very clear intent to deliver for people. Not fixated by growth in GVA figures. A shift to a values-led approach. And the work that we've been doing, we've been pushing really an open door. This is what people are asking. Again, you won't be able to see this, it's too small, but that's the conceptual part of the diagram. A series of themes, key themes of thriving communities, an inclusive economy and a just transition. The levers that we can use, community wealth building, networks, investment, and the key work streams and sectors which already are functioning under the growth deal. These are our priority outcomes on the right, and I'm going to just take you through those one by one. So fair work, it's come up time and again. But a region which offers fair work, education and training, including lifelong learning for all. And we're talking about the types of delivery activities which widen access to jobs and employment opportunities. And there's already so many good examples of that happening. Access to training and lifelong learning, the facilitation of fairer working terms and conditions so that we build good employers across the region, and ensuring that the public sector uses its procurement spend, its ability to employ its own staff, and to set real good examples in how we can do that. Strong and innovative businesses, a region where businesses can grow, entrepreneurship and creativity can flourish. There's a need to invest in the digital infrastructure and the digital economy across both urban and rural. We need equal opportunity to access the digital economy because it's where so much happens. people to stay, to live and work across many of the rural areas is a key lifeline and that's a key opportunity leveller. We need to enhance our business support services. We need to think of these on a regional footprint because our businesses don't trade within a local authority boundary. They trade across a functional economic geography. But there's real opportunity to shape our business support services so that the curriculum of business support really embeds these principles of community wealth building. So when we're talking to businesses, we're talking to them about their responsibility to the local economy, to the local people and to the local place. There's a desire and a need to improve the quantity and the quality of the business space, and a real strong desire for the third sector to play a much bigger role in the development of the business community and to be viewed as part of the economy. A region where people of all ages have access to resources and live a healthy, full, and purposeful life. There's growing partnership with the health service across Ayrshire, but there's real opportunity to continue to deepen that, to continue to develop a really person-focused health system which delivers people an opportunity to play a fulfilling role in the local economy. And many of the components of that require childcare, transport, jobs which are local, the ability to take part and to play a productive role in that economy. And we've seen examples already around, examples of how employers can be more inclusive, can look at the systems and processes of recruitment, which often serve as barriers to many of the people who really do need access to those good jobs. So in terms of stronger places and communities, local economies that can sustain thriving communities, deliver good public and private services to residents and businesses. The infrastructure in our towns and our villages, the cultural and the social infrastructure which bring visitors, and empowering our residents to have a stake in improving all of these. Enhancing our natural capital, Ayrshire has an abundance of natural capital. We need to preserve it for next generations, but we also need to utilise it to build economic opportunity. We need to facilitate a transition to a net zero, low carbon economy. Solar PV, one example. But how do we get that solar PV system on every building, not just on council landfill sites? Now, the key to delivering this strategy is delivering in collaboration. And community wealth building is all about building those anchor networks, bringing together the institutions that have power, that have influence, that control spending, they control land, they control assets, they recruit a significant proportion of the labour market. If we're going to deliver a well-being economy for all, it can't just be the local authorities taking a lead and being required to deliver for everyone. So this has really been rooted in that partnership and that collaboration, and that's why it's so encouraging when we go to the CPP partnerships and hear this thirst and this desire to get involved in delivering economic strategy. Hospitals want to deliver economic strategy because they can see why it's so important. Colleges, the police, the fire, they can all see that they have a role to play in shaping the economy. And that is how the regional economic strategy is well to deliver for Ayrshire. Thank you.
all these presentations have stimulated some questions. So who would like to pose the first question? Over here.
Just a question about the procurement policy. I'm coming to build the building locality officer in East Ayrshire. Dealing currently with a client who is embracing all of the Commonwealth building ethics, but they are struggling to tender for council contracts. I'm just wondering, for people like that, should we be thinking about putting more of a bias on Commonwealth building in terms of our procurement policy?
More competitive, and I think that's
yourself, once the microphone comes around.
Hi, it's Marie from Glasgow. You will take the mic off me by the way. I've got two questions, Julie. The first one is kind of to Stuart, who talks a lot. It's quite inspiring to hear you talk about being imaginative, test, try not to fail. I've worked in economic development for 20 years, and I've seen us move away from that into very administrative and risk averse policies. How do you simulate the culture change at the top to move back to that? Let's try something, and if it feels, it feels, and let's learn from it. And the other point was about people, so I was going to ask, can I ask where your people are in the design of your community airports and strategy? We're very guilty of a lot of glass of talking about IQ institutions, organisations, a lot of the organisations in here are people that sit on lots of boards and lots of state groups. Well, where are the opportunity for actual people, citizens, to design the projects and policies services that we talk about in this agenda?
Thank you. Two very good questions. I think those are too easy to you, Sarah.
Demonstrations, right? It is showing what's possible, it's being able to point
where failure is actually celebrated. It's lauded. I read an article recently, and my adult brain can't remember exactly what it was, but it was something like most corporations like fail six times before they're successful, or something like that. I don't know. I made that up a little bit, but I read something like that. But it is celebrated. The difference is it's celebrated. It's lifted up. The ability that failure is seen as a learning experience, and so that culture shift needs to happen here. And I think it doesn't because it's public money, or it's nonprofit money, or charitable money, or whatever it is. You can't have that flexibility. I think we need to think differently about that because money is wasted all over the place anyways, and so we need to be able to do experiment and risk and learn from that.
Thank you for that very helpful question. It's been lots of good feedback. I'm giving got a bird's eye view here of lunch. There's three platters still to come, so we can still take another question. Maybe the last one. Gentleman in the middle over here.
Thank you. So all the examples we've heard today have been really inspiring. Clearly a lot of it has been focused on what a local authority and the public sector more broadly can do in terms of its procurement, employment, etc. Obviously the biggest part of the economy sits down with the procurement, something like the supermarkets, the petrol stations, the pubs, a whole lot of the economy. And I'm also pensive about the minister's challenge everyone about how we can use the legislative opportunity to make a bigger difference across Scotland. So I'd be really interested in your panel's thoughts about what you would want to see in the bill that might facilitate a community building approach for all those sectors that actually are quite distant from local government procurement change and CPP partner procurement change.
Thank you. So what would you like to see in the bill? Who wants to lead off on this?
They don't have a debt
And it's nearly ready. So one final question for me, for each of you. Just a quick fast fire here. Your top tip. We have here individuals from all over Scotland looking at community wealth building as a policy approach. What would be front of mind for you as a top tip that they should consider at the beginning of their journey?
I think I'd have to echo Sarah's comment earlier. We're not the experts, you're the experts. You've been really hard at work with us for the last 2 years and beyond. We're here to learn from you. And I think as a movement, as a community wealth-building movement, we're all needing to continue learning from each other, being honest and sharing examples of things that didn't work and being open to learning from each other. So I think the top tip is continue to build this as a movement. Beyond Ayrshire, and there's plenty of people from beyond Ayrshire in the crowd. So,
thank you. Katrina?
I think be really clear about your purpose. Why are you doing this? And I think that builds the momentum. We were really clear the economy wasn't working for us, and that was really a drive to get something new. And I think that really then was where the traction gained.
Thank you. Sarah?
And I think this is topical to the question of risk. Don't be afraid. And the moment is now. We actually literally don't have the luxury to perseverate right now. We have to act. And this is not something in the future. This is now. We need to make change now, or else we're going to continue to have these same crises over and over and over again. And if we just reactively respond to them without changing the way we do business, we're not actually going to address them. So it's overwhelming, but this is our moment, and it's the only thing we've got. So now, and don't be afraid.
Thank you. So thank you to our panel.